priority for every Christian. You have to decide whether or not you want to be a fan of God, of Jesus, or you want to be a follower. Okay? Anybody want to know what a fan is? A fan is someone who sits on the sideline. You cheer for the team. You get mad at the team if they foul, and then you go home. A follower is one who is going to be there. In fact, he's going to be out there on the field with you, trying to help you make that touchdown, helping you to win. You know, what a fan, when they go to the Super Bowl, the fans don't get any of the money that they get. You don't get the ring that the team gets. But being a follower, you would. So you have to decide.
Go ahead. I just want to praise you. Forever.
All of your blessings and honor, and all of our honor, they are
belongs to you.
Morning again, not only to you, but to our internet audience as well. So before we get started, let's take time and just bow our heads and let's just go before the Father in prayer. So Father, we just thank you and we praise you right now for another day. We thank you for each and every one that is here and is with us on the internet, Father God, as they not only hear what I say, but more so what you are saying to them. So we thank you, Lord, and we praise you right now for your mercy and for your grace. And I thank you, Father God, that you're using me, and as I'm becoming less and less of me, but more of you. So I thank you and I praise you for it right now, Father. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 You may be seated. So we started this month on close relationship with God, and the title of my message is Drawing Near to God, and this is part two. My foundation scripture was found in James 4:8, and I'm going to read it. It says, draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, ye sinners. Purify your hearts, ye double-minded. And I gave you a brief exegesis of that, and using an example of two magnets, you have the opposite, and as they draw toward each other, they have a tendency to be attracted. But if the polar is the same, positive to positive, it has a tendency to repel each other. When we talked about clean hands, we were talking about us from a physical aspect, about us doing what all that we know to do to be right with God. And to purify your heart is a spiritual thing. It is you getting your hidden agenda together and straight. And being double-minded is, I mentioned, is being a slight spiritual adultery. You're in love with God, but you're also in love with the world. You can't do both. So the purpose of this message is to help believers to develop a closer relationship with God. And my goals today is, one, I'm going to give you a review from last week for those who were not here. And we're going to talk about developing that personal relationship with God. And number two is learning to draw near to God. My next one is how-tos, summary, and then a review. And we're going to accomplish these goals. I only have two. One is that the believer will be able to better understand what a close relationship with God means. And the second one is that a believer will be able to improve their relationship with God.
Amen.
Okay? So now for a review. I said last week, I said normally when I teach on Thursdays, I have a pops quiz. So you guys didn't get one last week, but guess what? You get one today. All right? So I'm going to ask you, what were the two books that we talked about last week? And, see, Pastor was listening, he gave me the answers. All right, it was Pilgrim Progress and Hind Feet in High Places. Does anybody remember what an allegory is?
Parable.
It's a parable, right. And I gave you an example of one in John 15, 1, when he talked about the vine and the branches. And we said that we know that that's not what he was really referring to. He was referring to Jesus and to God and to people, right? It's interesting to know that when you're reading the Bible, it's full of allegories, full of allegories, especially the book of Revelations, when he's talking about the candlesticks and the woes, and all of those are allegories because it's saying one thing, but it means another. So I'm going to give you a brief Reader's Digest as part of my review on what the books were, and if you were not here. The first one was On the Pilgrim's Progress, and this was written by John Bunyan. It was written in 1655, and it has been in print for over 200 years in over 200 languages, would you believe? And this book is about a man named Christian who wanted to go to the celestial city. Now, the celestial city, in here, he's talking about heaven. If you were Jew, you would say Olam Haba, which means the world to come. And it talks about him and his trials and his tribulations and him carrying these burdens. They're like sacks on his back of different things like unforgiveness and strife and bitterness until he gets to the place of destination. And we said this place of destination is what? Heaven. That's true. No. Place of destination is the cross with the open grave of Jesus. Jesus was raised from the dead, and from there he drops his burdens into the grave. But he doesn't stop there. He goes on because he wants to get to heaven. And so now he has a new gown, he has a new passport, and he still has some different challenges to meet. But he does get to where he's supposed to be. In the other book, Hinds Feet in High Places, is based on the scripture out of Habakkuk 3:19, and it's a story about a woman named Much Afraid. It's her name. And she has accepted the Lord, so she has met the Good Shepherd. Who's the Good Shepherd? Jesus, right. And so this talks about her goal from being a baby Christian on to becoming a mature Christian. And when she reaches her goal, her name is then changed from Much Afraid to Grace and Glory. Isn't that a blessing? I also gave you the scripture in Matthew 16, 24 through 26, when it says, Jesus said unto his disciples, if any man shall come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. So when we are carrying the cross, it is to follow Jesus. And that's putting away our old self and learning to be obedient to him. Now, I also talked in main point one, we talked about the choice between heaven or hell. And I use the scripture in Deuteronomy 30, 19, it says, and I call heaven and earth to record this day against you that I set before you life and death. I said, you have a red dress and you have a blue dress, remember? Blessing, red, cursing, blue. Therefore, it's open book test. He said, choose life, and that both thou, which is you, and thy seed may live. So it's so important that our first step on this journey toward Jesus, toward the cross, toward our destination, is to accept him as our personal Lord and Savior. Now, whether most of y'all realize it or not, you have two main purposes for reasons for being on this earth. Now, there are a lot more subtopics, but you have two main. And this includes everybody. You don't care how you got here, whether you was illegitimate or you have been raped or however. The point is, everyone here has a purpose and a reason for being here on this earth. And don't let anybody ever tell you anything different. Your first one is one is to choose your final destination. Or you want to go to heaven, or you're going to hell. It's like a fork in the road. You're going to take the left fork, or you want to take the right fork. And the second one is, everyone has a purpose that God has put in you to do. Can I share a little Jewish story with you? They have this thing that, you know, the reason why you have this divot right here, right up under your nose, it is saying that when you're in your mother's womb, God imparts your whole life into you. And just before you're born, that your angel says, shh. And that's why you have that little divot there. That's just a little something. They have a lot of little sayings and stuff like that, so you take it how you want. So now the right road is in Romans 10:9-10, and that means accepting Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior. And so we know when we do that, it starts us on a whole new adventure, and we're learning how to become who God has called us to be. My main point too is developing that personal relationship with God by growing in spiritual maturity. So in Ephesians 4:14-15, it says that we henceforth be no more children tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the sleight of men and by cunning craftiness, whereby they lie in wait to deceive. But speaking the truth in love, may grow up into him all things which is the head, even Christ. So as I mentioned earlier, it's all important for everyone to know what their purpose is in life. Some come here as babies, they already know what their purpose is. I've had children young as 4 or 5 know God had called them to preach. That's good. Well, some of us have been that lucky. Some of you all are saying, well, I think I know what he wants me to do, but I'm not sure. But that's okay. And some of us don't have a clue. You haven't even bought a Bible. So, but it's okay too. That's why he is our Father. He says, ask, and I will tell you. Also, you have to understand, just because you are here and you have a purpose, doesn't mean that everybody's been called to the fivefold ministry. It's like God did not call everybody to be a carpenter or to make shoes. Somebody's got to make clothes. Somebody has to be a plumber. So there are different things that God has called us all to do. All you need to do is plug in. Some of you, God has just called you to be moms. That's a blessing. Do you realize you are the first teacher that children get a chance to spend time with? The first few years, you have concentrated anointing to minister to little Pedro and Escalita. You help to lay that foundation for those children so that they are able to walk and stand strong in the admonition of God. There's some of you that God has called you to be teachers. You too have a very important part. I know when I was in school, our teachers, I went to some Simmons High School, and it was interesting then because most of my teachers were black. And because of that, they had a sense of pride for themselves and for their race that they imparted to us that unfortunately, a lot of our kids now going to integrated schools don't get. And so they would teach us different scriptures and stuff, not so much from the Bible, but they would use like what we would call like the Message Bible or the Living Bible, but that you still got that substance, that foundation in your life. So if your teachers, praise God for you, but God has put a purpose, a drive in you to be able to minister to those young children. It is so important that we have to understand that growing up in God is important. We all can't stay babies in kindergarten. God doesn't need us all to stay spiritual babies. When's the last time you have sat down with a 1-year-old and had a discussion on quantum physics on how the earth was born. They will sit there and look at you with some puzzled eyes like, I hear your voice, but Mom, I have no idea what you're talking about. That's the way it is with us. God wants someone that he can walk and talk and share things with. But saying a baby is not it. Spiritual maturity is something that should be a priority for every Christian. You have to decide whether or not you want to be a fan of God, of Jesus, or you want to be a follower. Okay? Anybody want to know what a fan is? A fan is someone who sits on the sideline, you cheer for the team, you get mad at the team that they foul, and then you go home. A follower is one who is going to be there. In fact, he's going to be out there on the field with you, trying to help you make that touchdown, helping you to win. You know, what a fan, when they go to the Super Bowl, the fans don't get any of the money that they get. You don't get the ring that the team gets, but being a follower, you would. So you have to decide, what are you going to be? You're going to be a follower, or you're going to be a fan? So Jesus' goal is for us to move before, beyond that basic elementary teaching, and for us to move into the image of him. So in Hebrews 6:1, it says, therefore, leaving the principles of doctrine of Christ, let us go on unto perfection. That means getting past the elementary stages of teaching and moving toward the advancing, the steadiness, and completion of perfection from not laying against the foundation of repentance for dead works and of faith toward God, of doctrines of baptism and laying on of hands and the resurrection of the dead, and of eternal judgment, and this will we do. So what he's saying is, these are all good, but we need to move past those things. These are things that we should already know and understand and use them as a foundation so that we can go on and mature in Christ. Now, we have a tendency we talked about followers. So a follower would be like a disciple. And sometimes we have a tendency to mix discipleship with mentorship. They're similar, but they're not the same. A mentor is someone that you may, a mentee, you would be someone you would check in with a couple times a week to make sure they're doing okay. If they hit a speed bump, you may give them some words of encouragement, and then you send them on their way. Discipleship is a little bit more intense. That means you're going to spend more time with that person. If they've got a runny nose, you're going to wipe your nose. If they're having a temper tantrum, you're going to be there for them. I guess the closest way to describe discipleship would be like when you hear about the people training for the Olympics, and what happens is these ice skaters or gymnasts, they end up leaving their family and going and staying with their coach. They live in their coach's house, they eat his food, they drink his water, and they spend long hours, 10 to 12 hours or longer a day, training and practicing and doing it over and over again until they can reach a point they can do it without thinking about it. That's where discipleship comes in. So when we look at it in the Old Testament, when they had disciples, you would sit up under a rabbi from anywhere from 7 to 14 years. Now the interesting thing is, men, in order for you to do this, you had to get permission from your wife. So if your wife didn't give you permission, then you couldn't go. The reason is because while you're gone these 7 to 14 years, guess who has to run the house and is the breadwinner? Your wife. So she has to be in agreement to want to do these things. So after you have spent this time, in this sitting up under this rabbi, learning from him, then you will reach a point of becoming a rabbi yourself. Now, the average rabbi will have anywhere no more than 6 students at a time. Now, however, we look at Jesus, and in John 20:16, Mary calls him Rabboni. Now, Rabboni, you know, I used to think, oh, it's just a typo, you know, they just a little confused. No, a Rabboni is considered as a great master, which meant that he was over the average rabbi, okay? And because he was, meant that he could have more disciples than the average rabbi. So that will explain why Jesus had 12 rather than just 6. Another Rabboni, if you want to say, was in the book of the Old Testament, was Elijah. Elijah had over 200 prophets that he was ministering to, discipling. So we have to realize that there, and you know, a lot of them called him rabbi. That's okay. You think about, I guess in the military, if you were a sergeant, they'll just call you sergeant rather than always saying master sergeant or whatever kind of other sergeants they are. But when you say sergeant, you still know you're talking to whoever it is. So that's kind of why you find a lot of times in scripture, they just call him rabbi. All right. So I'm going to skip over, and we're going to come back to main point 3, but I'm going to skip over to main point 4. I was praying this morning, the Lord told me to do this, but anyway, we're going to talk about some how-tos. And my first one is, talk to him. In developing your relationship with God, you need to talk to him. If you are married and you have a wife or a husband, in order for you to have a relationship, you need to talk. If you have children and you don't understand your child, then you need to talk. My husband used to ask me, when do you talk to our son or our daughter? I said, you know, you have a captive audience when you're flying down the highway at 60 miles an hour. They have no choice but to listen. Nobody's gonna get out of the car. They cannot put earplugs in their ear and tune me out because that is not acceptable. So that meant they had to sit there and listen to what I had to say, whether they liked it or not. And I didn't find out how much my daughter was really listening to me until she went away to college. And when some of her classmates in college were wanting to do something wrong, she would say, but my mom says, but my mom says you shouldn't do such and such. To the point, they would say, we need to meet your mama, because she had done a lot of talking, but that's part of it. You need to talk. And that's the way it is with God. You need to talk to him. He tells us to, in Hebrews 4:16, it says to come boldly to him and talk. Sit down and talk to him. If you got a problem, say, Lord, Father, I need to talk to you. When I have a challenge, I'll say, Father, I need to talk to you. Come and have a seat. You want a cup of coffee? Because we need to talk. Don't be afraid to talk. And you don't need to use your Elizabethan English. You don't need to use your proper English. You talk to him the way you would talk to your friend. If you're not the one to want to talk, then write. Some of you all are beautiful in writing. Then write a letter like you write it to your closest confidant, and you know that this person is not going to share with other people what you're saying. But talk to him. You may reach a point where you just may be angry with God. If you're angry with him, tell him. Get upset with him. Yell at him. Shake your fist. He don't care. He already knows you're angry. So tell him. If you gotta cry, cry. What it does, crying is a cleansing, it's a healing thing. So yell at him, Lord, I'm mad at you. Why did you take my mom? Why did you do this? His shoulders are much broader than you can ever imagine. So you need to understand that is something that you need to get rid of. Don't be afraid thinking if I yell at God, he's going to hit me with a bolt of lightning. Because he won't. He loves you. I remember watching YouTube, and it had this lady, she was in the military, and she was in formation. And her husband was there with their son. I guess his son must have been about 3. And he spotted his mom in the formation, and he broke loose from his dad and went running across the field, yelling, "Mommy, Mommy, Mommy," and ran up to his mom. Do you think she stopped? Didn't pay him any attention because she was in formation? No. She stooped down and picked her son up. She said, "I'll deal with the consequences later, but this is my son." Amen. This is where God is with us. Sometimes the only thing you can get out is the word Jesus. And you'd be surprised how fast he is going to respond to you. He knows when you're in distress. He knows when you're not in distress. So it's so important. There are some times when you just want to say, "Father, just can I just put my head on your shoulder or put my head on your chest and just rest?" It's okay. You can do that. You know? Because sometimes, I remember when my son was young, he was always active doing stuff. And if you try to hold him, "No, put me down, put me down." But then something happened where he's not feeling well or he's hurting. Then I couldn't get rid of him. And I realize even now at 40-some years old, my son, if he starts calling every other day, "Odell, something is wrong." "What do you mean?" "Because Brian has called us 3 times this week. There is something wrong, you know, because normally we go maybe a week or two and don't hear from him. So we figure no news is good news, okay?" And God would be the same way with us. If you just want to, "Lord, I just want to sit close to you. I just want to be close." That's fine. He, what did I say about drawing near to him? And you can sit there and just let him minister to you. And he will give you a new perspective on whatever your problem is. Give you a new surge of energy on what you need to do. So God is so awesome about these things. My next one is learning to listen to worship music. You want good music. Not, I don't want to say junk music, but music is not scriptural. You know the song that says, "Lord, we're climbing up the rough side of the mountain." That is not a scriptural song. We know in Matthew 11:23, it says, "Speak to the mountain." It didn't say, "Climb the mountain." So it's so important to let the new worship music minister to you. Just let it just fill your soul and your spirit. And if you have tears, let the tears flow. That's fine. I know when the praise team plays sings here, their songs, my spirit will sing them songs for 2 or 3 days after we leave church. Then I'll wake up in the middle of the night to go to the bathroom, and my spirit is finishing up a chorus to the song. So I know that it was singing it from the beginning all along, but it will wake me up. And so it's just the way of doing things. The next thing is read your Bible. I know we use the King James Version here, mainly because most people have a King James Version, and it makes it easy for us to all be on one accord, which is fine. But you know, but there are other scriptures, there are other translations that may help you to better understand what he's really saying. In 2 Timothy 3:16, it says, all scriptures are ordained by God. So there are people who say, "Well, you know, the Bible contradicts itself." No, it doesn't. You think it does. The only reason why you think it contradicts itself, you have to understand, Jesus was raised a Jew. His disciples were Jewish. Most of all the prophets in the Old Testament were Jewish. So they are going to write scripture from a Jewish Eastern perspective. We, on the other hand, are Westerners. So we see the scriptures from a Western perspective. So it sounds like it's being contradictory, but it's not. It's not. It doesn't hurt even if you get, you have a Jewish, there's a Jewish Bible, but it's written in English, if you like, in order to help you to better understand, especially if you're having scriptures that you're having some challenges with. And number five is stay connected. Our scriptures in 1 Peter 5:8, it says, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, comes as a roaring lion, walking about, seeking whom he may devour. You need to stay connected to Christian friends. If you have a good church, you need to stay connected to your church. When you start reaching a point where you feel like your Christian friends are boring you and you don't feel like you need to go to church, that's, you should see that as a warning sign. And you should put forth even more of an effort to stay connected to your Christian friends and stay connected and involved in your church. Have you ever watched movies on when they're in Africa and you have a pack of wildebeest running? As long as they stay in the pack, they're safe. But when they start wandering off and taking their own path, then they end up getting caught by the lion and end up being his dinner. Well, it's the same thing that happens with us. When you start reaching a point where your friend, you feel like your Christian friends are boring you, church is not exciting, then that's a warning that he's trying to separate you from the pack. And then what happens is all crazy things start happening and you can't figure out why. It's because you have allowed yourself to be a victim of him. Of course, the main person is, in all of this, is focusing on Jesus. And my scriptures in John 14:6, it says, Jesus said unto him, for I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. Remember that Jesus is not a way. Jesus is the way. And he is, no matter or regardless of how many of your achievements that you have made in life, what special talents you have, you still have to come to the Father through Jesus. Why? Because God chose him, and Jesus volunteered to do what he's doing. How many of y'all believe that Jesus only showed up in the New Testament? Ooh, that's good. I'm glad y'all know that. Jesus was there from the very beginning. Amen. I'm going to give you a quick Hebrew lesson. Some of you all on Thursdays, I have shared this with you guys. But the first word in the Old Testament, Genesis, English is in the beginning, right? Well, in Hebrew, the word is Bereshit. And it starts with a B because Hebrew, each letter has its own story. In English, when you say beginning, it's all it means is beginning. But in Hebrew, each word has a meaning, and each letter of the word has its own meaning and history. So when we look at Bereshit, it starts with the B, or Beit, which stands for son. And so to make it short, I'm going to say that one word, Bereshit, means that the Son of God died on the cross. That's Reader's Digest version. Okay, so that's the first word in the Hebrew Bible that talks about Jesus and the cross. Then as you go through the Old Testament, and each book, it talks about the blood, when they put the blood on the doorpost before the Israelites left Egypt. And what did they do? They said, you put the blood over the lintel, right? and on both sides. What did that represent? The cross, okay? When Balaam went to curse the Israelites when they were in the wilderness, and they said he tried to curse them, but each time he looked out over them, all he could do was bless them. Why? Because he was looking at the cross, because she had the ark in the center of the tabernacle. Then out from each side, from the north side, you had three tribes. On the south, you had three tribes. At the east, you had three tribes. And the west had three tribes. So what did you have? A cross. So he could not stand there and curse them while he's looking at the cross. There is a book called The Scarlet Thread. And what it does, it goes through each book in the Bible, especially the Old Testament, and it tells you and shows you Jesus and how he was represented in each one of those books in the Old Testament. So we know Jesus did not start in the Gospels. He started in Genesis, and he came all the way through. Okay? And the last one on this one is learn to examine one's heart before each and every deed or action. And I'm using scripture in Luke 14:28. And it says, when you pray, learn to count the cost of your action. Set aside a fixed time and a place to spend time with God. It's important that you learn, that you set time aside. You have a particular place that you go, and you find out as you do, God will meet you there. Anybody remember Clemente? He was a prophet. He said he would spend a lot of time with the Lord. And on some days when he is so busy that he doesn't get his time in, he said, then God comes looking for him. I said, ooh, that sounds awesome. And I was asking God about that. He said, well, I did the same thing with Adam. He said, I came in the cool of the day looking for him. Because he said, I missed my time with him. So as you learn to spend time with God, then he wants to spend time with you. And you'll find sometimes he'll come and kind of urge you. You don't realize what it is, but you say, I just need to spend some time with God. And so it's so important that we learn how to respond to him and doing those things that he's asking us to do. All right? So learning to draw near to God. Learning to draw near to God is with a sincere heart of giving us full assurance that faith is giving us, our hearts are to be cleansed from a guilty conscience and before being our bodies being washed in pure water. And my point in this one is we must draw near with a true heart. And I'm using the scripture in Psalm 51:6. It says, behold, thou desirest truth in the inner parts and in the hidden parts, that thou shalt make me to know wisdom. It's important that we learn sincerity means to be dependable. There are some of us who come to God and we're sincere. And there are some of us who come but you're not truthful. And truthful means being honest. You can't be sincere and not be truthful to God, which means that you have a hidden agenda. So it's so important that we learn not to divide our attention, but to do both. Because as you do, then God can use you in doing things that he's called you to do, which is so important. The next one is draw near with confident faith. In Hebrews 10:22, it says, let us draw near with a true heart and full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. It means to worship in faith is to come with a seeking heart that rests in the merit of Jesus alone. Drawing near to God in worship contains a condition that every believer is responsible for, and it indicates that we have already been met by the atoning work of Jesus Christ. So important. The next one is drawing near with a clean conscience in Romans 8:1. And there is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Jesus Christ, who will walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. And we know that we can only come with the sincerity of faith, which means our hearts are sprinkled clean, and is purging us, our hearts, from an evil conscience, which guilt is gone. So when a believer's conscience has been cleaned of guilt, a sinner comes to Jesus, receives salvation, and guilt is removed. Sometimes we feel the symptoms of sin. We feel the symptoms of sin even though we've confessed our sins. And I don't know if I shared with you guys or with the second service. There was a guy I used to work with, story of y'all not. And he always had this volatile personality. You know, one minute he was up, one minute he was down, whatever. And he would just really knew how to rub everybody the wrong way. And I remember praying and asking God to help me to understand him so that I would hold any bitterness toward him. And so it's so important that when we do that, what God will do, instead of you seeing him, you're on the same level with him, God kind of raises you up so you can look and see them from his perspective, which is so awesome. So when he would get to the point where he started clowning and carrying on at work, I could just sit there and smile because I knew that that wasn't really him. So one day, God gave me the opportunity to talk to him. And he was telling me about he and his sister had an argument. And right after the argument, she left to go home. And on her way home, she was in a car accident and was killed. Well, the problem was he felt like the car accident was his fault and his sister dying was his fault. And this had happened years ago. So in the midst of all this, the Lord put it on my heart to tell him that his sister had forgiven him. God had forgiven him, but it wasn't his fault. It was just something that just happened. I said, but the problem is you need to forgive yourself. And tears started welling up in his eyes, and he said, I can't do that. Well, I got a chance to minister to him more because he jumped up and ran out the room. I went after him. We went in the nurse's lounge, and I closed the door, and I stood with my back against the door. So then he had to come past me to get out so we can finally get this thing settled in him once and for all. And he finally was able to release it. So sometimes there's some of you out here who are still holding on to guilt to something that happened to your family or loved one. You need to let it go. They have forgiven you. God has forgiven you. And the thing that's holding you back is that you haven't forgiven yourself. You need to let it go. That stands between you and you being able to develop that closer relationship with God, which is so, so important. So, in summary, is important that we know we need to draw near to God. We need to know that he is drawing to us as close as we are to him. And in review, we talked about the two books, Pilgrim Progress and Hinds Feet in High Places. And both of these were allegories from a Christian walk. My foundation scripture was found in James 4:8. In my first point, we talked about the choice between heaven and hell, and my scripture was in Deuteronomy 30:19. My second point was developing the personal relationship by growing in the spirit, spiritual maturity in Ephesians 4:14-15. Main point three, which I kind of moved to main point four, was learning to draw near to God. And my scriptures in Psalms 51:6. And main point four was my how-tos. And we talked about how to talk to God, listening to worship music, reading your Bible, staying connected, focusing on Jesus, and learning to examine yourself. And my time is up, and I thank you for yours.